At 11:17 a.m. local time on December 27, 2024, a damaging tsunami began striking western Peru with wave heights of up to 6 meters or 19.7 feet. This tsunami wave would cause the most significant damage in Cebu Blanco, but continued to expand outwards from its source, eventually causing many millions of dollars in damage across more than 200 kilometers or 124 miles of coastline. By the time the last of four distinct tsunami waves had arrived, many hotels, businesses, and homes were damaged, but what was most affected by the destruction were fishermen and port infrastructure. Conflicting reports suggest anywhere from 20 to 600 small boats were damaged or destroyed, multiple docks were destroyed, and, as a result, 81 ports across the country were closed. And yet, if you turned on the world news, you probably didn't even see this story get a mention. And, of the local Peruvian sources which are covering this natural disaster that has affected many people, they are largely getting the details wrong. These sources are incorrectly attributing the generation of these damaging waves to an uncommon weather pattern, when in reality the waves just witnessed were actually true tsunami waves. Yet, no large earthquake occurred to trigger these, which I believe is the source of this confusion, so what exactly triggered the tsunami? Remember, for a tsunami to be generated, all that is needed is for a large volume of water to suddenly become displaced in a rapid manner. While earthquakes can cause this via the rapid motion of a very large fault line by several meters, landslides are often forgotten but still fairly common triggers for tsunamis. And the latter is what I interpret occurred here. This landslide was seemingly detected by seismic sensors across a 50-second-long period beginning exactly at 11:09 a.m. local time. This landslide had four distinct spikes in activity, likely representing different blocks, with the second being the largest, hence why four tsunami waves were produced, with the second of these being the tallest. While we do not yet know exactly where this submarine landslide occurred, I have a decent educated guess. If we look at the altitude profile of the seafloor to the west where the highest tsunami waves were observed, we can see the following. A continental shelf of the South American plate, which is fairly flat until it experiences a continuous drop-off on the continental slope before reaching a lesser slope of the continental rise, which then eventually connects directly to the boundary between two plates via what is known as the Peru-Chile Trench. The behavior and timing of the tsunami waves which arrived suggests that they originated via a collapse of a portion of the continental slope. The collapses which occur on this portion of a continent have a special name, being known as turbidity currents. These turbidity currents occur after large enough volumes of sediment accumulate on the edge of a continental shelf that destabilizes its edge. This process eventually causes both the sediment and volumes of underlying harder rock to start moving, eventually collapsing all at once and carrying hundreds of millions to billions of tons of rock all at once, which scour the underlying sea floor. While turbidity currents are fairly common events worldwide, I believe what occurred in Peru was the generation of an abnormally large one near shore. It is uncertain if additional sections of the same landslide site that I presume exists could also collapse in upcoming days, but it is something to keep an eye on. December 27th tsunami may end up being the first true mainly turbidity current linked tsunami to strike since the 1929 Grand Bank tsunami impacted Newfoundland and Canada. As a final note, I would like to thank my new patron Salsby for supporting this channel.